Welcome to this video lecture of mechanical properties of the concrete. When we are making concrete, we give too much attention to its composition, to its grinding, the company from which we have taken the cement, from where we have taken the aggregate. But we never thought about the mechanical properties of the concrete. As a civil engineer, we should understand that all those things which we have considered during manufacturing of cement, during selection of aggregates, during selection of water, it affects on the mechanical properties of the concrete, such as on elastic modulus, on Poisson's ratio, on creep, on shrinkage, and on durability of the concrete. All of them are very important factors to be considered. In this video lecture, we will discuss about those mechanical properties of concrete which are responsible for its long life and for their strength. In the first topic of mechanical properties of the concrete, we will discuss about elastic modulus or modulus of elasticity. It is a measure of stiffness of a material. The stiffness of component means that how much it can deflect under a given load. It is very important parameter for designing a product which can only be allowed to deflect by a certain amount, by a smaller amount. For example, bridges. This modulus of elasticity of concrete can be defined as the ratio of applied stress to the corresponding strain. It does not only demonstrate the ability of concrete to withstand deformation due to applied force, or you can say due to applied stress, but it also explains about its stiffness, or we can say it in another words, that it reflects the ability of concrete to deflect elastically. This modulus of elasticity of concrete is sensitive to aggregate and mixture proportion of the concrete. That is why knowledge of elastic modulus is mandatory to make deflection check regarding the serviceability requirements. In the design of concrete structure, this modulus of elasticity is important, that requires to be defined. The linear analysis of elements, which is based on elastic theory. And in most of the cases, it is used to satisfy requirement of ultimate and serviceability limit state. For example, in the case of pre-stressed concrete structure. It is one of the two factors which can determine the stiffness or rigidity of the structure, which is comprised of a material. The another factor is moment of inertia, which is a purely geometric property of a structure, which is purely dependent on the cross section of the structure. So in identical product, the higher the modulus of elasticity of the material, the greater is the rigidity. It means that if you double the modulus of elasticity, then you got double the rigidity value. And the greater the rigidity of a structure, the more force must be applied to produce a given deformation. We can also consider flexural modulus, in which a bending stress instead of a uniaxial compressive stress is applied. The deflection produced is recorded and the modulus is calculated from the ratio of stress to the strain. It may be more appropriate to use the flexural modulus to determine the short-term rigidity of the structure on the case of bending, particularly if the material comprising the structure is non-homogeneous, as in the case of fiber-reinforced material or foamed material. The next topic is Poisson's ratio. It is the ratio of lateral strain to longitudinal strain in a material which is subjected to loading. Poisson's ratio varies between 0.1 for high strength concrete and 0.2 for a weak mixes or weak concrete. So normally we take 0.15 at the time of strength design and 0.2 when we are considering serviceability criteria. It is recommended to practice great caution to ensure that Poisson's ratio is compatible with values used for shear modulus of elasticity of concrete, otherwise error can occur. Generally, Poisson's ratio of concrete is constant up to about 70% of the strength. It can be computed from static modulus test. Even at the time of ultrasonic pulse velocity, we are using this Poisson's ratio. And if you want to find it out that how much Poisson's ratio is for that particular type of concrete, then also USPV test can be done. And from this fundamental resonant frequency, we can find out the Poisson's ratio. It is in a formula, we can see that if the Poisson's ratio is V, then it is equal to minus ratio of lateral strain to the longitudinal strain. Next topic is creep. Now, what is creep? When deformation is time dependent due to sustained load. Now, this creep can be indicated when strain in a solid increases with time, while the stress which is producing the strain is constant. I am repeating again this line, that when the stress applied is constant and the strain is increasing with time, then this strain is known as creep. It is the increased strain, or you can say it is the deformation of a structural element under a constant load. It depends on the construction material, structural design, service conditions, etc. this creep can result in significant displacement of the structure. Now, severe creep strain can result in serviceability problems, stress redistribution, pre-stress loss, and sometimes failure of the structural element or whole structure can fail. This creep can occur in three stages: primary stage, secondary stage, and tertiary stage, or stage 1, stage 2, stage 3. It is more transiently, we can say, the creep does not follow a steady rate. The creep rate begins to accelerate as the cross-sectional area of the element decreases. And how it is decreasing? All of you know about necking at the time of stress strain test. You have heard about this term, necking. Now, as the necking is increasing, it means that internal voids are decreasing and the effective area of the specimen or the element is decreasing. Now, this creep can be reduced by using the correct water cement ratio. It means that when the water cement ratio is at its minimum, then the creep can be decreased. As it is written here, that the ratio of creep is increased with increasing water cement ratio. And in the same condition, humidity. It is influenced by humidity. It is influenced by drying condition, which has been provided through the atmosphere. Likewise, I can say about age of concrete. As age of concrete increases, creep can develop. Next is aggregate. Now, for aggregate, I can say that size of aggregate is a very important factor. Large coarse aggregate reduces the creep. Even compression steel also reduces the creep. For example, if the compression steel is used in concrete beam, it reduces long-term deflection. And if you use some admixtures, then this creep can be reduced or controlled. The next topic is shrinkage. Now, what is shrinkage or what is drying shrinkage? Because concrete shrinks when it dries, when it dries down. So this drying shrinkage is defined as the contacting of a hardened concrete mixture due to loss of capillary water. This shrinkage causes an increase in the tensile stress, which may lead to cracking, internal warping, and external deflection before concrete is subjected to any kind of load. This volumetric change of concrete structure due to loss of moisture by evaporation is known as shrinkage of concrete. It is also a time dependent deformation which reduces the volume of concrete without the impact of external forces. Drying shrinkage happens mainly because of the reduction of capillary water by evaporation and the water in the cement paste. The higher amount of water in the fresh concrete, the greater is the drying shrinkage effect. Concrete shrinkage occurs mostly due to evaporation of mixing capillary water. Now, in this shrinkage, I will discuss about different type of shrinkage. Then the first one is chemical shrinkage. Chemical shrinkage is the result from the difference between the product from and reactants during cement hydration. As hydration continues, the product occupy a smaller volume than that of the reactants, which can be seen in the figure that when chemical shrinkage occurs, how the cracks has been developed at surface or in the structure. Next is autogenous shrinkage. This autogenous shrinkage, it is change in volume due to chemical process of hydration of the cement, exclusive of effect of applied load and change in either thermal condition or the moisture content. Next one is drying shrinkage, which we were discussing, that it is the result from loss of capillary water from the hardened cement mixture, which leads to contraction and crack formation. So by addition of plant fiber, such as nowadays banana fibers are using or sisal, it increases the drying shrinkage problem. Another one is carbonation shrinkage. This type of shrinkage occurs when carbon dioxide enters into the hydrated cement particles or hydration cement minerals. It carbonates the calcium hydroxide to calcium carbonate, and the carbonation slowly penetrates the outer surface of the concrete. That is why this type of shrinkage mainly occurs at medium humidity and result in increased strength and reduced permeability. Next type of shrinkage is thermal shrinkage. As I had told you earlier also, when there is a thermal gradient, it means that when the water from the surface is evaporated and there is a wetness inside that top surface, then there is a thermal gradient developed, due to which the top surface will try to harden or try to induce tensile stress, and the surface adjacent to that top surface, it restrained the top surface to develop the tensile stress, and due to which cracks may develop on the top surface of the concrete. The last topic of this mechanical property is the durability. It is the ability of concrete to resist weathering action, chemical attack, and abrasion. while maintaining its desired engineering properties. Different concrete require different degree of durability. It depends on the exposure conditions of the environment. Actually, durability is the ability to last a long time without significant deterioration. A durable material helps the environment by conserving the resources and reducing the waste so that the impact on the environment can be repaired and replaced. The production of replacement building material depletes the natural resources and can produce air and water pollution. Concrete resists weathering action, chemical attack, and abrasion. While manufacturing its desired engineering properties, you have to note down that different type of concrete require different degree of durability. It depends on the exposure environment and the properties which are desired. Concrete ingredients, their proportioning, interaction between them, placing and curing procedures, and the service environment determine the ultimate durability and the life of the concrete. In general, the design service life of most buildings is often 30 years. Although building often lasts 50 to 100 years or longer because of their durability. Most of the concrete and masonry buildings are demolished due to their functional obsolescence rather than deterioration. However, a concrete shell or structure can be repurposed if a building use or function changes or when a building interior is renovated. Concrete as a structural material and as the building exterior skin has the ability to withstand nature's normal deteriorating mechanism as well as natural disasters. Now, there can be certain factors which may or may not affect the durability. There are certain exposure conditions. So, what are those conditions? What are those factors? So, some of the factors I had enlisted below, such as high humidity and rain. Now, in this point, we can discuss that when there is very little or no organic content, then the concrete is resistant to deterioration due to rot or rusting, due to hot humid conditions, hot humid climates. Now, moisture can only enter in the building through the joints. Now, where are those joints? These joints can in between the concrete elements. For that purpose, annual inspection and repair of the joints will minimize this potential also. More importantly, suppose that moisture has already entered through the joints, then also it will not damage the concrete. It will damage only the wood particles which are used in the concrete. Now, the next topic is ultraviolet resistance. That this ultraviolet portion of solar radiation, it does not harm the concrete. Using colored pigments in the concrete retains the color in the aesthetic element, that is wall or floor, long after the paints have faded due to the sun effect. Now, third point is inedible. In this topic, we can discuss about insects, vermin. Actually, vermin and insect cannot destroy the concrete because concrete is not edible. It is inedible. Some softer materials are inedible, but still they can provide the pathway for insect. But due to its hardness, vermin and insects will not bore through the concrete. Next point is moderate to severe exposure conditions for the concrete. Now, there are some important exposure conditions and deterioration mechanism in the concrete. Concrete can withstand this effect when they are properly designed. Next is resistance to freezing and thawing. The most potentially destructive withering factor is freezing and thawing while the concrete is wet, particularly in the presence of some chemicals. Deterioration is caused by the freezing of water, due to which there is a subsequent expansion in the paste or in the aggregate particles or in both. When it has proper system of microscopic air bubbles, which can be obtained through the addition of an air entraining admixture and uniform mixing, then the concrete is highly resistant to freezing and thawing. These microscopic air bubbles within the concrete accommodate the expansion of the water into ice, and thus it releases the internal pressure generated. Concrete with a low water cement ratio, that is 0.4 or lower, is more durable than the concrete with a high water cement ratio, that is 0.4 or more. Air entrained concrete with a low water cement ratio and an air content of 5 to 8% of properly distributed air voids can withstand a great number of cycles of freezing and thawing without any stress, or you can say without distress. The next point is chemical resistance. Concrete is resistant to most natural environments and many chemicals. Concrete is regularly used for the construction of wastewater transportation and treatment facility. Why? Because of its ability to resist the corrosion caused by the highly aggressive contaminants in the wastewater. as well as the chemicals which are added to treat these waste products. However, concrete is sometimes it is exposed to the substances which can attack and cause deterioration. Concrete in chemical manufacturing industry, even in the storage facility, is prone to the chemical attack, such as the effect of chlorides, sulfates. These effects are discussed in another points also. Acid attack concrete by dissolving the cement paste and the calcium based aggregates. In addition to using concrete with a low permeability, surface treatment can be used to keep aggressive substances from coming in contact with the concrete. You can discuss the effect of hundreds of chemical on concrete and can provide a list of treatment to help to control these chemical attacks. Next point is resistance to sulfate attack. High amount of sulfate in soil or water can attack and destroy the concrete, which is not properly designed. Sulfate, when I am saying sulfate, it means that it can be calcium sulfate, it can be sodium sulfate, it can be magnesium sulfate. They can attack the concrete by reacting with the hydrated compounds in the HCP, that is hardened cement paste. These reaction can induce sufficient pressure so that the concrete can disintegrate. Natural rock such as limestone or porous concrete is susceptible to the weathering action caused by salt crystallization. The salt, you can take example of sodium carbonate or sodium sulfate, etc. This sulfate attack and salt crystallization are more severe at location where the concrete is exposed to the wetting and drying cycles. If it is continuously wet, then also possibility are there, but they are more dangerous when they are continuously getting wetting and drying cycle. For the best defense against external sulfate attack, concrete with low water cement ratio, that is less than 0.5, or you can say less than 0.4, it should be used along with the cement or cementitious material combination, which is especially formulated for sulfate environments, which we had already discussed in previous topics. Next is seawater exposure. Concretes are generally used in seawater exposure for decades, and they are giving an excellent performance also. However, special care in mix design and material selection is necessary when this severe environment is there. A structure exposed to seawater is most vulnerable in the tidal zones, Why? Because there are repeated cycles of wetting and drying or freezing and thawing. Sulfates and chlorides present in the seawater requires the use of low permeability concrete so that you can minimize the steel corrosion and sulfate attack. There are some cement are also available which are resistant to sulfate exposure. You can use them also. Or proper cover over the reinforcement must be provided. Next point is chloride resistance and steel corrosion. Chloride presents in plain concrete. It means that where reinforcement steel is not provided, is not at all a durability concern. But in reinforcement or when it is reinforced, then also the paste, that SCP, that matrix, it protects the embedded steel. It protects from corrosion. Now, how it is protecting? Because it is highly alkaline in nature. The high pH environment in the concrete, usually it is more than 12.5, causes a passive protection oxide film to form on steel. However, the presence of chloride ions from seawater can destroy or penetrate the film. Once the chloride corrosion threshold is reached, the electrochemical current is formed along the steel or between steel bar, and the process of corrosion begins. The resistance of corrosion to the chloride is good. However, for severe environments, such as in the case of bridge decks, it can be increased when you are using a low water cement ratio, such as less than 0.4. Now, in the case of bridge, it can be moist also. So you can also use some supplementary cementitious material such as silica fume so that the permeability of the concrete can be reduced. There are some other methods also to reduce the corrosion. It includes the use of corrosion inhibiting admixture or agents, epoxy coating over the reinforced steel, surface treatment, concrete overlays, and cathodic protection. Now, the next factor is alkali-silica reaction, or you can say the resistance to alkali-silica reaction. Actually, alkali-silica reaction is an expansive reaction between certain forms of silica in the aggregates and potassium and sodium alkalis in the cement paste, because alkalis are already there in the cement. The reactivity is potentially harmful only if it produces significant expansion. Indications or the presence of alkali aggregate reactivity is a network of cracks, closed or spalling joints, or movement of a structure, etc. Alkali silica reaction can be controlled through proper selection of the aggregates and or use of supplementary cementitious material such as fly ash, blast furnace slag, etc. Or you can use blended cement. They are proved to control the reaction. With some reactive aggregates, controlling the concrete alkali level has also been successful. Some lithium based admixture are also available in the market, so that the deleterious effect due to alkali silica reaction can be controlled, can be minimized. Next point is, or next factor is, abrasion resistance. Concrete is resistant to the abrasive effect of ordinary weather. Example of severe abrasion and erosion are particles in rapidly moving water, floating ice, or areas where steel studs are allowed on the tire, or if the tire get punctured and the person is driving the vehicle on the rim only. Actually, abrasion resistance is directly related to the strength of concrete. For areas of severe abrasion, some studies show that concrete with compressive strength of 12,000 to 19,000 pounds per square inch may work well. This is how we can find out that what are those factors and what are those methods by which we can minimize the effect of above all, so that we can make our concrete durable. We can make our concrete subjected to less creep. We can find out the elastic property of the concrete. All those factors are very important to understand, to minimize the deleterious effects. I hope this topic is clear to you. Thank you.